a fountain of new birth.
Our visions and hopes are refreshed and renewed.
For God has taken ordinary things
and made them extraordinary. Sing a new song.
First reading today is Ephesians 2, verses 19 through 22, which is a picture of God's work and reconciliation, both individual and among groups. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God.
Gospel reading this morning comes from John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31, where Jesus appears to the disciples. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them, and he said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with him when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger on the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord, my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Excuse me, Marcia and Joanne, we have a sermon going on. What are y'all doing? Step in? Oh, okay. Well, it seems to be for Lighthouse Sunday of Hope that we have our local two artists who have been inspired to share their spiritual gifts with us this morning as we reflect on the life. So you just make yourself at home. Can I get you coffee? A margarita? Oh, David said yes. Not you, sir. Not you. Last Sunday, we celebrated Easter. Wow. What a wonder it was. The jubilation filled this building and this church, celebrating the resurrected Christ. It's quite a spiritual experience. We're still in the Easter season, according to the liturgical calendar. But then I start reading the text again. Then I go back, and as we heard in the passage today, Jesus says, "Have you believed because you've seen me?" And that started ringing out to me. Then I look back in the 20th chapter of the Gospel of John, which Marcia and we had a drama presentation last week. We noticed that Mary Magdalene, when she went to the tomb to anoint the body, Jesus wasn't there. And he appeared, and Marcia thought it was the gardener, didn't you?
I did.
But when Jesus spoke, you quickly learned it was Jesus. But you didn't recognize him, neither did Mary Magdalene. Then in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, we have a story after the resurrection, the journey with Jesus along the walk to Emmaus with the disciples. And in that story, they didn't recognize Jesus. And I'm starting to think, what's wrong with these people? Then the story immediately after today's story about Thou and Thomas, the disciples are out fishing and they're not catching any fish at all. And someone from the bank yells out, "Take your nets, cast them on the other side." And they catch 153 fish. But at first, they didn't recognize Jesus. And doubting Thomas, what is wrong with him? "I won't believe unless Jesus proves it to me." He wouldn't recognize Jesus. I never realized how often the stories we read in the Bible, they didn't recognize Jesus. And it got me to thinking, do I recognize Jesus when I see him? How many opportunities have I lost myself when I didn't recognize Jesus right in front of me? Now, pray about it. Why? Why don't we see Jesus? Why didn't they recognize the risen Christ? And it came that maybe the point is the focus needs to be for us to look at the inside, not the outside. We know through humanity, looking at the outside gets us in trouble, doesn't it? We judge people by their mannerisms, even the color of their skin, the clothes they're wearing. Some people wearing certain clothes, we look away when we encounter them on the sidewalks. Other people, we make eye contact. "How are you today?" I believe this is a lesson for us. But didn't the disciples have enough faith? Or maybe they didn't expect Jesus to reappear. Because that's what we find in the story. They're locked in the upper room, behind locked doors, huddled, swallowed in their fear and their doubt. But even through those locked doors, Jesus appears in the midst of a storm. I see Jesus appear around here. I see Jesus delivering 7,000 meals a year in our social hall next door to people who are hungry. I see Jesus in our congregational care team. When they like Jesus, they appear either through a phone call, in person, a hospital visit. I see Jesus when our choir sings and you're filled with the Holy Spirit. But today we find Thomas and the others locked in this room, huddled, swallowed up, drowning in their own fear and their doubt. It's interesting, when we plan worship way ahead, the theme came, I mentioned it to Wham, the Sunday after Easter, most churches downsize. All my pastor friends, they're off today. One's in New York seeing Hello Dolly on Broadway. Like, really? Jealous. Fires take off. We've worked hard, we need a rest. the church. Now, I always think about people who come to church the first time on Easter, and they come back the next Sunday and go, what happened? What happened? Was it real what they talked about last week? Did they see Jesus? But how do we respond by what's on the inside? I invite us to think about that today, not the outside, but we as Christians are what we are on the inside. Our faith and our doubt and our trust in God. Jesus gave us the example. So, on Monday afternoon, I received a phone call. Howard Kaplan, who's our I call church angel. He helps. Man, if you're in need, call Help Me Howard. Many of you know I'm kind of short, group cut, so full of life. My gosh, he makes me look like coming. Whatever. But he is. He energizes me, Howard. He calls me almost every day, Pastor, Pastor, you won't believe who we're able to help. I'm like, okay. He's so excited about ministry because he had his own journey that he lived through and God rescued him. He wants to share what was done for him with others. So the phone call, and Howard has a job in town for a restaurant. He delivers meals to the offices and to the courthouses for this restaurant, this family which took him in and cared for him, loved him, and loved him. He's in the hospital. Howard was hit by a car. Is he okay?
Yes.
But he needs help. So I talked to Reverend Fred and the other members, and I travel down there as fast as I can get there. They take me back to the trauma unit. Walked in. There Howard is in the corner on a stretcher. No one around him. And I walked up and I looked and he had dry blood all over the side of his face. And an open wound on his forehead. The nurse came over and said, how is he? Well, he's going to be okay, but he has a fractured femur in his leg. He's going to have surgery in the next few hours. Sit next to Howard, not praying. He starts opening his eyes and I said, Howard, what do you remember? I don't remember anything, Pastor. I just remember being here right now. Am I going to be okay? God's in charge. The nurse comes back and she sees he's awake and the nurse says, Sir, what year is it? And Howard says, 2017. Good. The nurse says, what city are you in? Howard says, Fort Lauderdale. And I looked at the nurse and I said, be very careful. He's a Democrat. Do not ask him who the president is. You're supposed to help people. And Howard looked and puzzled, and I finally said, let me give him a good question. Howard, tell the nurse who your favorite pastor is. He goes, Reverend Fred Gray. And I said, nurse, pull the plug. I said, no, to the nurse, he's fine. I know he's fine. Because I'm glad people have a favorite pastor in this church, right, Fred? Absolutely. Pastors can be your friends. Wow. So we start to talk. And he said, what happened? I said, while you were out, I called your employer. And she said, a man came into the restaurant after you'd been hit and said, you know the man that works here with the crew cut, heavy set, kind of short, that delivers the meals? He's been hit by a car. He needs you. Stranger knew who Howard was. She rushed down, got to see him, and he took him to the hospital. I said, are you in pain? Dumb question. But you know what he says? He said, I'm blessed, Pastor. I'm blessed. I said, what? I'm grateful, Pastor. I'm grateful. What? You just got hit by a car, Howard. He said, I'm grateful that I have health insurance so I can get care. I'm grateful that the injuries weren't worse than they are. I'm grateful that I wasn't killed. I'm grateful that I have nurses taking care of me. I'm grateful that our church is here with me. And he wouldn't stop. And I said, rest. But that attitude of gratitude filled the room. We could see Jesus. Look what Jesus went through for us. We could see Jesus. He had surgery later at 12:30 that night. The surgeon says he's going to be okay. We put some rods in. He'll have to go to physical rehabilitation. Good. I get a phone call yesterday morning. Pastor, y'all need to bring me communion here. I said, well, of course. No, not just for me, but for about 20 people. What are you doing? He says, I can walk. And I'm walking down the hall of the hospital and I'm praying and people are saying, what's this about? They want to know more. They can see his faith in action. And he's serious, Red. He needs about 20. He says, they want to know about Jesus. They can see his life. They didn't see what was on the outside with the big wound and still there and can barely walk down the hall. What they saw was the light of God right in front of them. That's amazing. Last night, I heard that there's a lighthouse in Florida. Didn't know that. Drive up to Lighthouse Point. Got there an hour before sunset. Sit on a bench. What an amazing thing. Well, first, getting there was a whole other sermon. And the people who helped along the way. Numerous people. But I looked on my phone and it said sunset's at 7:48. So I'm sitting there and I'm focused. And a lady walks by and she sits down. Writing a sermon for tomorrow. It's about the lighthouse. She was intrigued. We're talking, and as we sit there talking, and I'm listening about who she is and where she's from, all of a sudden, it got dark, and the light came on in the lighthouse. And we both looked at each other, and we gasped. And then as she prepared to walk away, I said, can I ask you a question? I said, sure. I said, what's your name? I know. If she said Mary, it would have freaked me out. I would have been like, I'm out of here. Her name was Donna. Oh, Jesus was sitting right next to me. But like Thomas, Howard wasn't caught up overwhelmed by the fear and the doubt. How he wasn't drowning in that sea. Howard was counting his blessings, and he kept singing to me, "His eye is on the sparrow, and he watches over me." Wow. It's truly amazing. He relied on what was on the inside to me, even when the outside failed him. But my favorite part of Thomas's story is it shows, it demonstrates for us the kind of relationship God wants to have with us, which is personal and individual. Because Thomas, he got a bad rap. He should be called Courageous Thomas, because he took his fears to the Lord and he says, "I need proof." And Jesus says, "I'll provide that." In an intimate way, touch the nail marks in my hand. Put your hand in my side where the wound is. How intimate, spiritually intimate, can it get? So the doubting Thomas story is a lighthouse for us. So instead of shaming Thomas, how can we be like Thomas? How can we be the Jesus-like behavior set the example for us? How can our faith and trust in God be like Jesus? How can we be the lighthouse? Jesus in the scripture tells us we're a temple. How can this temple reflect the light of God? The light of Christ is housed within each one of us, and the invitation is to let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Are you all done yet? You're finished? How about before communion, would you come back and can we share your artwork and your spiritual gift with the congregation? Don't go far away. Sit over there. You'll be singing over there. Thank you.
Oh,
words of God's very grace. And this is a small personal testimony. I'm new to this church, and I am very at home here and have received such a warm welcome. And to see this church cultivate and highlight talents, all different talents, is such an amazing experience, and I thank you all for including me.
Well, I'm really speaking from the heart, but I did write some things down because I don't want to mess up either. First of all, I just want to say that I feel that I am blessed beyond measure, and I don't even know how to begin to say thank you. How can I possibly repay? And I realize with gratitude that among my blessings are the artistic talents that God has bestowed upon me. And here I am at UCC Fort Lauderdale, my beloved church home. And this is another blessing. I have found the perfect venue to share my talents, which I enjoy so much, and in so doing, hopefully bring more people to the joy and peace of knowing God, of knowing Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Marsha and Joanne, is this incredible? They're spiritual gifts. The car says, let me see. Isn't that incredible? The lighthouse. The other thing that really strikes me odd, or maybe not, is how it's raining today. Isn't that just truly? Take God's all around us. And as we leave. invite Bill, would you put the picture up from the ordination yesterday? The resurrection message is to expect the unexpected, isn't it? And yesterday, in this church, in this place of worship, a holy Catholic church came here, and three priests were ordained here in this church, in this Protestant church. Reverend Joel and I attended. No, my plan was to sit in the back and just, you know, support. And they said, "Oh no, come be part of the service." The invitation was given and taken. That's truly amazing. Absolutely. And this week we celebrated Earth Day. So I invite you, as we partake of communion today, to think of the grain in the grape and where it comes from God's creation. Here at United Church of Christ for Lauderdale, this is God's table. Everyone is welcome here. Anyone who wants to experience Jesus, we invite you to come forward. Let us pray. Loving God, Creator of all things, we ask that you help us make the decision to roll away the stones, to remove, to unlock the doors that, whether we impose on ourselves or society or humanity, free us and forgive us when we doubt that we've been created to be anything less than a child of God. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
touched today by God's love and grace while viewing our worship service, and we hope to see you in person one day. We at the United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, are an open and affirming church that believes in equality for all. We have many ministries that reach out to the needs of those in our community, and there's always something here for everyone to be involved in. We believe that God is still speaking and that our ministry outreach can only continue its vital mission in bringing people to Christ through the support of people just like you. Please visit our website, uccftl.org, for more information about us, to submit a prayer request, or even donate to the church if you have been moved by the Spirit. You will help us in God's work in our ministry outreach. We look forward to hearing from you soon, and we hope to see you next week. May God's peace and love be with each and every one of you. And remember, God is still speaking.